this quick video, short video, in relation to sort of do's and don'ts, a little bit of tips on movements, exercises in relation to hip replacements. Similar to a lot of other joint replacements, it can either be a full replacement or a partial. So you can either do the acetabulum, replace that, or the head of the hip, or both together, full hip replacement. Again, you need to be guided by what the consultant has said. The consultant rather than the GP, because they're the experts, they're like brought in this matter, as to the best advice as to what they can, what they can't do. And likewise, your insurance company, realistically, if anything went wrong, you'd really need to have something in writing, as far as they wouldn't cover you if you didn't have anything in writing saying they specifically could do that exercises. As a general rule, as with most things, you do pain-free but not discomfort-free. There are two rules of thumb to try and abide by in relation to hip replacements, and that is, we don't want to avoid taking the leg across, or much more across, the midline of the body. So you want to take it across the body. You don't want too much adduction. Certainly wouldn't go past the other hip line. The general rule of advice is you don't go past the midline. Realistically, when you're walking and doing your general things, you go slightly beyond that. A lot of it also will be guided by what they're used to doing, what their consultant has said they can do, and how far post-surgery, and if they've had any issues. It can get quite complicated, but keeping it simple. Is it pain-free? Has the consultant said it's okay? The doctor said it's okay? But as a general rule, you don't want to be taking it really past midline, pure and simply because the hip is looser, it's laxer in that position. Just think of what, there's the head, there's the acetabulum, the head of the femur's in there. As you roll it that, as you take it that way, it's more likely to come out on anyone. Theoretically, it's more likely to come out and subluxate, or to come out of its joint socket in that position, especially if there's force applied that way. That's the only reason, because the joints are slightly more unstable. The other one is, you don't really want to be taking it past 90 degrees. So not higher than that, not much higher than that. You go with a little bit, but not too far. In other words, you wouldn't have them forward flex, certainly on the back doing rollover type stuff. You probably want to avoid that. Again, usually that's more in the earlier stages, but it's something to bear in mind for similar reasons. The laxity of the joints in that position. Now, what you'd usually be looking at for people that have had, and even people that are just about to go in for surgery, is strengthening the musculature around that area, including all the glute muscles, all your external rotators, your short external rotators, which is six, your glutes, your hamstrings, your quads. See, some hip flexors as well, because they act as help keep back in the joint, the hip flexors. I know sometimes I bang on them, they're a nasty thing, especially the psoas, but they all help, all these muscles help fix that into the joint, the head of the femur into the acetabulum. So you're usually looking at not just mobility, is what we always seem to focus on, but you're looking at strengthening those muscles, so that stays, the head of the femur stays firmly in the acetabulum of the ilium on that side, or whatever side you go to the right on it. So that's what you usually look at, range of motion, increasing the range of motion, but more applicable for them as well, psychologically, is the strength of that, to keep it in there. And that's where you're reinforcing them in there, or building up strength to help keep that joint stable. And again, that certainly applies to a lot of other joints as well, certain things you can do to make them stable. Same with the knee, for argument's sake. I know everyone bangs on about physio-wise, they bang on about the quadriceps, but the calf, gastrocnemius in particular, and the hamstrings play a massive part in knee stability. There's a whole host of muscles which we've already mentioned in relation to the hip. So there's nothing wrong at all in taking it out and down, out to the side. There's much range of motion, pain-free, and not taking it across the midline or too much past 90 degrees. So there's loads of movements that you can do there. You just need to have consideration in a class, from a class point of view, making sure some of that hip replacements, that you keep an eye on them, or you forewarn them at the start. They'll usually know what they can and can't do. Again, a certain amount of it is apprehension, more so the hip joint than the knee joint. It's a certain personality, used to be referred to as A-type personality, so you probably need to keep an eye on them, because they don't fully understand, as we've explained, to that personality type. So they say, yeah, I'll take it across, not realising the reason why we're not taking it too far across the midline. It's physics, it's mechanical. I think your joints are far more likely to go pop and pop out again. It's not a case of it's harder, it's more tougher, it's challenging, I'm not allowed to take it there, therefore I will take it there. So you just need to be conscious of those personalities. So I'm not going to label the movements, the exact movements that you can do in relation to that. There's a whole host of them. A lot of it on the involved side is about strengthening. Now, realistically, what you'll tend to find, as a general rule, and it goes on about, it goes for, it doesn't really go for the knees to be honest with you. And that is, let's have a hip replacement here. That one is usually, all things being equal, a little bit, oh, it's okay. It's usually the other one that you'll find needs the mobility. If we're after especially if we're after balancing the body, it's usually the other side. And one of the main reasons being, they possibly, the hips are the same age. They've had roughly the same wear and tear. Obviously one has gone for whatever reason, we favour that more, for whatever reason it might be an accident, that they've had to have that one replaced. They're usually not looking, some people not looking too far off, either having it replaced or there's issues in the other hip. So you generally tend to find that's not the problem. Maybe strengthening it is. It's the other one usually from a range of motion point of view. So hopefully that makes sense. That's a bit contradictory. As a general rule, when people have had joints replaced or even accidents and issues, we're after strength and mobility. We want all muscles strong and flexible. In relation to hips, it's use a lot of the time. It's strengthening the side of that hip replacement in. That's a big psychological boost. That'd be explaining what you're doing. And range of motion usually in the other one, trying to increase the range of motion because they usually lack range of motion. And what they're usually looking for isn't really the involved side. It's trying to keep this as mobile and active as they can, so they're trying to delay having hip surgery on that for as long as they can. So it's not anything specific exercises. You know the exercise, you know loads of movements that you can do. It's just being careful with people that have hip replacements, bringing it like a single leg stretch, bringing it too far into the chest. They just want to take it a little past midway. If anything for them, it would be the other leg they need to increase range of motion in. They've usually got range of motion in that one, and the reason I don't advise taking it right the way in is purely simply from an insurance point of view. Say a consultant, again, it'd be different if you got something in writing from the consultant that says, no, actually, the type of surgery you've done, the type of material that we've used is such that they may be able to take it X, Y, Z. As a general rule, you don't take it. Take two, you don't take it much further than that. On that note, that's it finished.